Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. Hope you guys are doing all right. Been busy getting everything with the orphanage all straightened out, or trying to. Never-ending story, brothers and sisters, you know. Work is never finished until the Lord calls us home. So praise God for all those who are praying. Ask you guys who are prayer warriors for Joshua's ministry to keep praying. You know, the Lord has given me these other ministries too, praying with people in the States. The Lord has just had me in a season of where I'm running into people who I prayed with before, like I posted one video, who were healed. I guess the Lord is going to start using me in that area again more because I keep running into people. And, well, I've been praying with people around here just lately. It's just been a trend the Lord's had me on and people getting healed. So I praise the Lord for that. And the Lord was just reminding me today, I was discussing it with my wife. I praise God. As I mentioned before, the Lord had used me before in a gift of healing a lot when I was newer in the ministry. And then especially since I've been in the Philippines, I've shifted more toward the prophetic, and especially with this YouTube channel, brothers and sisters, and with the Church of the Firstborn. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I praise God as we're looking for the rapture of the church. The rise of the kingdom of Antichrist is near. And the Lord is just, you know, putting on my heart just to get in that last harvest. So the right word, you know, we talk about revival. And, you know, I've done revivals in lots of churches in the States before, and then I'd always... The first night, you know, the Lord had given me this sermon, you know, what revival is not. You know, so I did this whole teaching on what revival is not. Revival is not a series of meetings, as an example. Revival is a sovereign move of God. So that's what I wanted to talk to you guys a little bit about. The Lord has been showing me all kinds of cool stuff. And I always want to make all these short videos and put them out, especially like for non-believers and stuff too, or new people who don't want to watch a long video. As an example, you know, the Lord has been showing me so many things, or, you know, it's been pondering in my mind whether it means something or not. I don't know. As an example, there's the four popes. We just had yesterday at the Vatican four popes. You know, so there's the two popes who were alive, and then the two popes who were canonized were declared saints by the Catholic Church within the, you know, their doctrine. That's what they do. They declare people to be saints. Whereas we who are Bible-believing evangelicals and Pentecostals, the Bible says that, you know, we believe, the Bible clearly teaches that all people are saints who are born again. There are separated ones, called out ones, holy ones. All those who are truly born again are saints, according to the Word of God. But in Catholicism, they declare people to be saints through a process, you know, of canonization, where they have to be, you know, and I don't want to get into all that. It's not important. It's not important. The point is that there's two popes alive who were honoring and canonizing two other popes. That even gets into your duality and all that but the four significance of the four, of course, the four blood moons, the four horsemen of the apocalypse, all those things that the Lord had talked to me about, that I made a video the other day about the four blood moons. It's just another example of four, of something to catch your eye. Now, even if you're, you know, a Catholic, and, or, you know, a non-believer who, you know, lots of non-believers, they think, you know, even in Islam and all that, when they think Christianity, hey, they think of the Pope. Those who are not Catholics, and not all non-Catholic Christians are Protestants. Protestants is the old mainline denominations. Lutheranism and in those old original modern day denominations since the time of Martin Luther, but evangelicals and Pentecostals. Even if, you know, there's lots of people who think, you know, the Pope is the Antichrist, and some people say that he's not the Antichrist, but they don't agree with the doctrine. Whatever your position is, it doesn't matter. In the fact that Catholicism is 1.2 billion people. You know, so that's 1/6 of the world population. So anything that happens with the Vatican is very significant. It's just like, you know, a lot of Americans believe, oh, America is so important in world history. It's true. We're the only superpower left in the world. But America is only 300 million people out of almost 7 billion people. So even the President of the United States, supposed to be the most powerful man in the world, only has power over it's like 300 million, whatever it is in the United States, 300 and some odd million. Whereas the Pope has theological power over 1.2 billion people who are throughout the world. Basically every country on earth has some Catholics. So they are the largest group of people of affiliation, I believe, in the whole world. Islam is about 800 million. So Catholicism is the largest, the Pope actually has the greatest influence upon numbers of people. You know, we talk about Billy Graham here in America. Billy Graham's influence is worldwide, but still nothing compared to the Pope in the world. So anything the Pope does is very significant. Anything that happens, anything he says is actually more important than anything President Obama would say or anybody else, human on this earth. So that's why the potential is there, is for prophetic fulfillments, something to happen. The announcement of there's so many different theories and stuff. I want to preach about the Lord, but I've already done this video. Let me give scenarios. I've mentioned in videos before. Let's just say as what the Vatican Observatory is doing, which is run by Jesuits, or some people say Jesuits, which is very annoying to me. Jesuits, the Society of Jesus, they call themselves. The Counter-Reformation militant, they consider themselves soldiers. Their leader is the general, aka the Black Pope. And this current Pope is a Jesuit, the first Jesuit Pope. And their observatory and all that is Dr. Tom Horn and Chris Putnam have dug out through their research from the mouths of their own stargazers. They're looking for the aliens to come here with a better gospel, because maybe the aliens haven't fallen like man. They're a creation of God that didn't fall. So therefore, they know God better than us. They have a better gospel than us. They're here to help us and save us. This is a huge possibility of being what will bring in the new world order, what would unite the world, even as President Clinton just said the other day, and President Reagan said at the United Nations, that he'd often thought that an invasion from space would unite the world. And it's true. Can you imagine all those people in the Catholic Church, and those, especially those old mainline Protestant denominations, they're the worst for not believing the gospel and not having a real biblical belief. The worst, the old mainline Protestants. All of your, a lot of your Joel Osteen people and the Crystal Cathedral people, the power of positive thinking people, liberal Christians, they are not really in faith anyway. So those kind of people that, they believe in evolution and they're part of Christendom and they're just kind of, out there, the people that probably wouldn't die for Jesus, be willing to lay down their life, but would deny the Lord as opposed to laying down their life. If the aliens were to land and say, hey, we are the gods that created you, and then the Pope, the Jesuits, this is what they're looking for. You imagine the Pope coming out and saying, hey, I'm endorsing these. These guys are our superior spiritual beings, or superior beings in the universe, in creation, and therefore, let's listen to them. Let's throw out what we know and get a better gospel, a new gospel, a different gospel from these people. I could see that happening, because that's what they're looking for. That's what the Jesuits are looking for. They're looking. If you watched Tares Among Wheat, these documentaries, there's a series by this Chris Pinto going through, even though it's not only about the Jesuits, but that's a big part of it. If you study the history and everything of what they're promoting, really is to do away with the Bible, do away with the Word of God, and bring the whole world to submission to the Pope. But if the Pope himself comes out and says, hey, I've got the keys of Peter, that's what they believe, I'm handing these over to these superior beings. I'm surrendering my authority as, the Pope claims to be the representative of Christ. These guys know more than us. Here's the keys to the kingdom in the eyes of the Pope and to all Catholics. You're talking about 1.2 billion people. Boom. You imagine all the Buddhists and Hindus and all that. When Buddha died, he said, continue to search for the truth. Buddha was actually an atheist. He was just a philosopher. It later became he was turned into some kind of a god, a deity. Hindus believe in hundreds or thousands of gods. All these people, you know, they're going to be coming out and saying, hey, you know, we can see this with our eyes. So if you imagine as probably the most biggest possible scenario, the most astounding scenario would be the aliens landing, as I've just discussed. So how this connects to the four blood moons and all that, of course, there's been tons of videos, many videos made about the blood moons, how it connects with a harbinger or, you know, a sign, as God says in Genesis chapter 1. You know, let me just continue on this topic. There's people running to and fro on YouTube, copying and I call them, they're called trolls, but you could call them, the copy and paste police, because they, you know, they're just copying and pasting what somebody else said, but they don't know what they're talking about. And they'll say that, you know, it's a false gospel. And like Dr. D. James Kennedy, who I mentioned before, he wrote a book, which I was really led by the Lord to get and read, but I didn't have time to get it and read it. Back when I first started in the ministry, he wrote a book about something about the gospel and the stars or whatever. And I was really in my spirit from the Lord to get that book and read it. By the grace of God, I'll get it one of these days and read it, because there's something stuff in there the Lord wants me to see, but that's been 10 years ago. But I would say now that it's related to what I'm talking about. There's copy and paste Christians, copy and paste police, who think that you're practicing some kind of astrology and astronomy and all this kind of stuff, whatever, by looking at the stars. But the Bible clearly says in Genesis chapter 1, I believe it's verse 14 maybe, Genesis chapter 1, it says that God gave the stars and the moon and the sun and all that for signs and for seasons. You know, and even as I heard a rabbi say the other day, look, God based the Jewish calendar off the phases of the moon, off the phases of the moon. So how much more important and amazing is this blood moon thing? Because God uses the moon specifically to base the Jewish calendar off of, specifically. Sometimes the sun is there too, but mainly it's off the cycles of the moon. So that's why we see, you know, the blood moons, as the Bible talks about, the moon would turn to blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord. Of course, there's been lots of blood moons, but the feast day things, people already made videos about it. I don't want to go into it. Significance being on a feast day. So we have these four popes. It also follows the line of the duality that the Lord has always leading me to talk about. To talk about these things. And I was just thinking, even the book that the Lord gave me to write. Here, I got it out. I'm trying to help Rosemary clean out her garage. Sister Rosemary has a bunch of these books left that we signed. I signed these books to get out to you. If you'd like to get a copy, please message me and I'll get you a copy of the book. But anyway, the Lord was even, you know, leading me about this because I want to make another video talking about for the non-believers and for atheists and stuff. What did you expect, you know, when you took prayer to school? What did you expect when, you want to make drugs legal? What did you expect with all the changes that we see in the United States? That's my video I'm getting ready to make. But by the grace of God. But anyway, the title of the book the Lord gave me is really duality. Look, it's Final Boarding Call. Satan's plan for the ages and our last mission. So what's duality about it is Satan has a plan and God has a plan. So that's what we're talking about. God's plan, and that's what I started talking about at the beginning of this video, is for the harvest to come in. The devil's plan is to kill, steal, and destroy and bring in the capstone of his plan, the Antichrist, where he will rule and reign on this earth for 7 years. And it says that he'll be given authority to make war on the saints and overcome them, the tribulation saints. Whoever will be led into captivity will be led into captivity. Whoever will be killed by the sword will be killed by the sword. This is the wisdom and the patience of the saints. He's talking about the tribulation saints. Whereas Jesus said, the gates of hell shall not prevail against the church. So we, the church, the true church, the bride, the real born-again Christians, who I believe are spread out over all denominations, though there's probably more born-again Christians and truly Bible-believing churches who are truly preaching the gospel, because faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. But in today's day, brothers and sisters, with the gospel available in Christian television, that's another duality. People keep knocking Christian television. I'm not a huge fan, and I'm not a fan at all of the late Paul Crouch or any of those people. But you know what? Millions of people, or maybe even a billion people around the world have been saved through Christian television, like TBN. Millions of people have got saved from what are, like I said, probably a billion people. So there's a duality. Tons of people have got saved from Christian television. They've heard the gospel. They've learned it. Whether they, you know, they're you know, just a Catholic, like in the Philippines. The Philippines is like 90% Catholic. And here they worship either the baby Jesus or Mother Mary as the two main gods here. But you know what? I've talked to thousands of Filipinos, and now I won't say that have told me this. Hundreds have told me that they watched Christian television that they broadcast for free here, and they got born again, saved, heard the gospel from Christian television. So it's been used by God, just like the internet, another duality. The number one thing on the internet is pornography, but yet again, you're watching this video that is a Christian video right here on the internet. So God uses the internet for His glory also, brothers and sisters. Just as the devil has a plan for the ages, which includes using the internet to bring pornography, to use the internet to bring, you know, hate and evil to the lives of people, whatever people might do through the internet. But God has used the internet to bring glory to His name. So brothers and sisters, you know, that's just a topic that's burning in my spirit. And I need to make a video on that too, as the Lord has led me. Give me about 10 videos to make. Another one is the role of America in the rise of the nation of Israel. Another duality, the United States. The greatest producer of missionaries, Bibles, scholarly theologians who are real theologians who know the Bible, and are professors of theology that have taught preachers from around the world the gospel, the end times, all that kind of stuff. You know, raising up proper biblical Christianity came from, you know, doctors of, as what we call theologians, you know, from the United States. The money for mission work, all this stuff, the primary source is United States. And of course, the rest is almost all your other English-speaking countries in the Western world. God has done this, but yet the United States is the number one producer of pornography. You know, we got drug addicts, and America has the most amount of people in prison of the top other like seven countries, developed nations combined. The United States has more people in prison than the next seven largest, countries in the world put together. So there's lots of dualities in America. We have racism, you know, especially in the past. We had slavery and all that. But yet our Constitution said all men are created equal, endowed with our Creator with inalienable rights, some of which are, you know, our life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. So we've had dualities. We have dualities in all things, brothers and sisters. We see there's the things that God does, there's the things the devil's doing. You know, even like on the YouTube video, you have your comment section. You know, 90%, praise God that 90% or 95% of comments I get are a blessing. You know, a good question or comment or encouragement or a praise report. And then there's the 2 or 3 or 4 or 5% that is from the enemy. But praise God, there's duality in everything. And so I just want to say this, you know, just as I was thinking today about the dualities. Of course, I'm just trying to say this in the right way. Look, there are people who are exhorters, and they exhort people to give people encouragement. But preaching the whole counsel of God is not just being an exhorter. I want to say that first. And, you know, we have to preach if you're a preacher, you have to preach the whole counsel of God. But as an example, the Bible tells us, Paul says to think on these good things, you know, whatever things are holy, whatever things are true, whatever things are lovely, you know, think on these things. So be positive. And that's true. We should always be positive and think on the good things, not on the bad things. So as an example, I would just say this about Pastor Paul Begley. One of the biggest things about his success on YouTube is that he keeps it positive. He is an exhorter. And he keeps it positive, and he goes with that. He accentuates the positive, and he eliminates the negative. And, you know, and that's what we as Christians should do. But as I said, I gave a caveat. We have to preach the whole Word of God, the whole counsel of God. You know, and so, you know, we have different callings and different ministries. And, you know, it depends on how you look at it. If you want to say unfortunately or fortunately, depends on if you want to look at it positively or negatively. Myself, God has given me I do some exhorting sometimes, and, you know, people love that kind of stuff. But, you know, sometimes the Lord gives me, the tough mission, that people don't want to do. You know, in other words, I want to be an Air Force guy for the Lord. But sometimes the Lord uses me to do the grunt work. You know, sometimes you got to be infantry. Sometimes you got to be, just like in the special forces, everybody wants to be a Green Beret or a Navy SEAL, but sometimes somebody's got to be the Rangers, the Marine Force Recon in the Army. They call it the Rangers. You know, they do the hard stuff like in D-Day, the Rangers there, they scaled the cliffs, the wall, they scaled a cliff there I guess that's at Omaha Beach, right beside Omaha Beach. Because I was there for, at the 50th anniversary of D-Day, back when I was in the Army in Germany. And anyway, the Rangers, they scaled this big cliff there, and, it was so dangerous, and everything they did was like the hard stuff. And then, of course, the regular guys, it was still hard. What they did storming the beach was still just as deadly. But the Rangers had the added situation of having to climb the cliff. The Air Force guys, they just came in and dropped bombs beforehand, and they weren't getting their hands dirty. They were staying up there way up high and not getting dirty. But sometimes somebody's got to get down there and get dirty with the devil's people. And like I said, I don't argue, not debating and arguing with people. It's not getting dirty. But getting dirty is getting, in close quarters combat, getting up in people's faces with the sword of the Spirit and the shield of faith, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, helmet of salvation, and feet shod with the preparation of giving the gospel. Always prepared to give an answer for the hope that lies within you, as Peter tells us. So, you got to be ready for the battle. And so that's what, we have to do. And I pray and believe that people who are part of the Church of the Firstborn, who are regular viewers of my videos, that's the ministry that the Lord gave me. And I believe that those who are regular followers of my videos, that's where God has called you to be. Because, as they say, birds of a feather flock together. And the duality and the negative side of that, if, as an example, you've got a teenage kid. Say you have a teenage daughter. She hangs out with a bunch of girls, and all of her friends are sleeping with their boyfriends. And then your daughter says, "Oh, I'm not sleeping with my boyfriend. I would never do that. I don't do anything like that. I'm a Christian. I'm a good girl." As I said, birds of a feather flock together. So if all of her friends are doing it and she's friends with them, but she's just, the Vestal Virgin there's something fishy in Denmark, as they say. Something's not right. Or another example, you have a teenage son and all of his friends smoke or do drugs or drink. And then your son is the innocent lamb in the crowd. You've been fed a line, and you've taken it, a hook, line, and sinker. So birds of a feather flock together, brothers and sisters. So, I want to prepare you for close combat, for getting right in people's face. And that's what we have to do sometimes. And there's lots of you, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. There's many of you, lots of people, they're not, they don't want to be the bad guy. They don't want to hurt people's feelings. But Jesus said, rejoice in that day for such as they do when they persecute you. Because that's what they did to the prophets. I mean, they crucified Jesus, not because he was handing out candy canes and grinning at people. I mean, that's what lots of people want. There's, someone told me, "Oh, in a lot of your videos, you've been like you're angry, and then you made some video that, and I made a video where I'm being really nice. When I made a video for non-believers, I was being really nice in there, really so overly nice as the Lord was leading me, for I made a video for Jewish people just a week ago or so. And people say, "Oh, you're just being so nice in that video." It's not about, we have to do the will of God, and there's a season for everything under the sun. There's a time to be mad and a time to be glad. There's a time to cry and a time to rejoice. So there's different times and seasons and places where God operates. So, Jesus, when he went to the temple and scourged, it says he made a cord, a whip with a scourge on it, and he scourged and beat and whipped the money changers in the temple. He turned over their tables with their money and scattered their coins everywhere and let loose the animals and ran them out of the temple. And it says, the anger from my father's house burned me up. the Bible tells us. The Lord was furious. Another time the Lord went in the temple and he called the Pharisees a brood of vipers. You know, then and that was like in Matthew chapter 22. Then in John, I believe it's chapter 8, he tells the people that you're of your father the devil. He tells them they're children of the devil. So Jesus got angry. Jesus was angry. They crucified him. He was not a people pleaser. The apostles were all crucified and killed. And John, they tried to boil him in oil, but he survived to get the book of Revelation and the letters that he wrote after the Caesar Dalmatian tried to burn him in oil. So to be a preacher, to be a Christian, is to be at enmity with the world, John tells us. Those who are friends with the world are enemies of God, Jesus said. John said that by the unction of the Holy Spirit. God said that through the Apostle John. So if we're, if we're a Christian, we're supposed to be at enmity with the world. In other words, we're salt and light. That means to oppose. So, you know, if everybody loves you, just like this, my favorite preacher, Leonard Ravenhill said, if the world crucified and couldn't get along with the Prince of Peace, the greatest man who ever lived, who fed the 5,000 and healed the lepers and all the things that Jesus did, how is it that the world can get along with you? That's the question. If they couldn't get along with Jesus and they crucified him and they killed all the apostles, how come it is that the world loves you? That's the question I would ask to any preacher or any Christian that everybody thinks they're so great and everybody loves them. If I ever had a chance to talk to Billy Graham, of course, he's a very old man now. You know, be very nice and respectful to any older person. And Billy Graham is a servant of God who deserves respect. But if I had a chance, I would ask him that in a nice way. What do you think, or how do you feel? Why do you think the world loves you so much? Why do you think the American people love you so much? Why is it the presidents who were not Christian, like Nixon and all these guys, why do you think they loved you so much? Johnson and all those guys who were actually pretty evil people. Why is it that they loved you? That's the question. Well, that's the question I would ask. So don't judge according to the flesh, but you have to judge in righteousness, brothers and sisters. And don't let the world be your judge. Let the Word of God be your judge. Let the Spirit of the Lord be your judge. Let His Spirit bear witness with your spirit that you're a child of God. God bless you guys. I shall return with another video. You know, that's a big deal in the Philippines. You know, I tell the Filipinos that all the time. You know, that's a quote from Douglas MacArthur. For those of you who didn't have a history, maybe not, you know, they say now in the schools they don't teach history anymore. But General MacArthur said he shall return to the Philippines. It's a famous big deal over here, especially still here in the Philippines, because he's really the hero of World War II for Asian countries, our allies like the Philippines. God bless you guys.